Welcome back. We have finally made contact with Cosima. And although she assured us that she was going to be fine and that we shouldn't put ourselves in danger on her account, we cannot just stand idly by and let her get married to that creep. And she also warned us about Alhazred's genie, whom I guess is the golden-eyed fellow we've been seeing around in various guises. But we must continue to find a way to help Cosima, which I guess means we must continue to explore the islands.
Alexander pulls out his magic map.
Well, let's go to the Isle of the Beast this time, since we haven't been there yet.
Alexander feels a strange pulling sensation.
You know, that really doesn't look very comfortable, does it? Getting pulled through a tiny hole in reality. And there we are, on the Isle of the Beast. According to the guidebook, the Isle of the Beast used to be known as the Isle of the Forest and was used for hunting game by the royal family, among other things, and was uninhabited otherwise. Until one day, as if by magic, the forest grew so dense that there was no way to get through it except via this path. And the sounds of a ferocious beast could be heard, thus giving the island its present name. It seems that no one has ever actually seen or met this beast. Although they seem to know enough about it, at least, that the queens would think the beast is responsible for stealing their singing stone. Very peculiar. Let's take a look around.
Alexander is standing at the edge of the sea on a heavily forested island. As far as the eyes can see, tall trees spread out their branches as though straining to link arms, their tops forming a canopy above. A path leads north through the forest. The dirt path starts at the sea and winds its way off into a densely wooded forest.
Bambi!
A little fawn is feeding on a grassy hillock near the sea. The fawn is too busy eating to pay attention to Alexander.
Also, this isn't the Isle of Wonder, so it probably can't talk anyway. Can we pet the fawn?
Alexander resists the temptation to pet the fawn, thinking he might frighten it.
Again, you're just way too nice, aren't you? Well, I guess, if anything, being the slave of a wizard will teach you to be polite. Because if you're not, you'll die. There are strange creatures hanging from this tree here.
There's an odd little creature dangling from that tree branch.
Also, pay attention to the music here. It is actually theme of the bookworm from the Isle of Wonder, although with a harpsichord thrown in, which is used in most of the music for the Isle of the Beast, as we'll find out later. So it's sort of the Isle of the Beast version of the bookworm theme. Let's see if we can find out anything about this peculiar-looking creature.
Hello, friend. Aren't you an odd-looking little fellow?
I'm not odd-looking, you are!
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't realize you could speak.
Speak not? Funny is, speech I am and nothing but.
He sounds like Yoda.
You speak strangely, friend.
Strange? My speech is not eloquence I speak with.
But who are you? And why are you here?
Away I've fly my home from. Lost I am, therefore. As my name, too, can you guess not? It's what I do this branch with, and the way I speak of.
He's away from home, isn't he? Well, if I were to guess, I'd say he's probably from the Isle of Wonder. What with the music and all, and the fact that he's just plain weird. Also, as for guessing his name, he is actually the dangling participle that the bookworm asked about as one of the things he would take in trade for a rare book. So, that's going to work out nicely then. However, one weird thing here is that he seems to imply that his speech pattern is his name, but what he does in his speech pattern is not a dangling participle. A dangling participle is a participle that is not attached to a subject and can therefore have an ambiguous meaning. An example of that would be walking down Main Street, the trees were beautiful, which sort of implies that the trees were doing the walking, which of course they were not. Or reaching the station, the sun came out. Again, this is ambiguous because it makes it sound like the sun was reaching the station. That is what a dangling participle is, and which is definitely not what he's doing. I don't know exactly if that was intentional or if they just made a mistake or something, I don't know.
If you're lost, perhaps I can take you home.
Take me home too? Think not I do. No, you I do not.
Oh, and yes, I did take those examples of dangling participles from Wikipedia. So sue me.
Are you sure you don't want me to try to find your home?
Trust you, I do not. Stay here, I will.
He doesn't trust me. I guess his mother raised him well. Doesn't seem to trust strangers. Based on his speech pattern, he might be interested in this apparently incomplete sentence. Well, let's see if he likes that.
Alexander holds the sentence out to the creature.
This sentence seems in need of an ending. Perhaps you could finish it?
Where are you going? Where are you going? Know what I do? Where are you going to? Like you, I do. Go I with you?
Yikes.
Well, that was certainly interesting. It looks like Alexander now has a passenger.
We actually have two passengers. Rotten Tomato and the dangling participle. It's getting crowded back there.
Take me home to...
Who speaks like that? Except him. I mean, I still don't get the whole where are you going to thing. I don't know.
Take me home to...
Can we get the dangling participle and Rotten Tomato to talk to each other?
Hey! Get that out of my face! Nah.
I guess not. Too bad. Would have been hilarious. Okay, well, I guess we should take him home to the Isle of Wonder, but before we do so, let's check out some more of this island. After all, we're here, aren't we? Okay, now that's weird. A boiling pond. Is there a hot spring nearby here somewhere?
A pond lies across the path. The water boils as if over some magical flame.
Very peculiar.
The banks of the pond, moistened by the stream, are slowly eroding away.
Stream? I don't see any stream. I just see a boiling pond.
Beyond the pond, the path continues into the forest. Alexander is traveling on a path through a dense forest. The woods on either side of the path are teeming with wildlife. Blocking his progress north is a pond that boils with a magical intensity.
Mushrooms as well here.
A pond lies... The forest is dotted with clumps of wild mushrooms.
Can we take the mushrooms? Maybe they will shrink us. Like the mushroom from Kings Quest 1.
Alexander, not being an expert on poisonous mushrooms, decides not to take a chance on tasting the local variety.
That's a good idea. Certainly makes him smarter than Graham would have been. He would have just eaten it and died.
An old abandoned hunter's lamp is hanging on one of the trees. Alexander wonders who might have hunted in these dense woods.
Could that perhaps be a lamp with a genie in it? That would certainly even the odds if we also had our own genie to combat Alhazred's genie with. But it does seem to be on the other side of this pond. Well, I guess this pond isn't all that dangerous. Let's just try and cross it.
Alexander decides to brave the boiling pond. And soon realizes a deep sympathy for soup vegetables as he learns the true meaning of being in a stew.
Hands up if you didn't see that coming.
Tickets out. Next.
It looks like Alexander's in a bit of a stew.
And that's not a good place to be, I guess. Okay, well, I guess we can't get that lamp then. And yeah, I know it looks like you should just be able to climb around it, but you can't. Deal with it. If only we had something we could use to cool this pond down. Like, I don't know, some lettuce made out of ice. Unfortunately, the last of that has melted away a long time ago. So I guess we have to go back to the Isle of Wonder and get a new one. Which, ooh, did you see that? It was a raccoon or something. Anyway. Which is a good thing, since we're heading there anyway, to bring this fellow home.
Alexander pulls out his magic map.
So, back to the Isle of Wonder.
Alexander feels a strange pulling sensation.
And we'll deliver the dangling participle to the bookworm in the next video.